usually kind of sets the table for dinner to be served. Kind of breaks the fallow ground for the seed to be planted. This week, Mike's been telling, he's had kind of a message on his heart, God's been put. And I just want to say how much I appreciate Mike and Deb. These two are willing to do anything, and such good hearts, and just to hear the stories about what they've been through in their life and how God's worked, what God's done for them, is just a real good testimony. Anyway, Mike's going to share some thoughts this morning that God's laid on his heart about just some of their journey and some of the things God's done. So I'll just let Mike share that for you. Thank you.
Thank you. It's different from up here. I talked to Daryl several months ago. When Deborah and I first came here,
Okay, Don, could you get the lights on that side? He's got a couple video clips, and just leave them off. Thank you.
When Deborah and I first came here, we really believed that God had brought us here for a reason, but we weren't quite sure. And God had brought us specifically to this church, and we were still trying to figure out what that was. But we knew when we moved to Ohio that He had placed in us a heart for hurting people. We had been through some incredible stuff in our lives, and we have been through that time, and we understand a lot of it. And we run into people every day that are hurting. And so God kind of put this message on my heart months ago when we first got here. But through the months, He's kind of been refining it till it came to what I want to share with you today. And talking with Pastor Darrell last week on the tales of what he went over last week, I just felt like this was the right time. This was God saying, this is the right time to share this. So I want to share this with you. But before I share it, I want you all to look around, and I want you to locate the nearest box of tissue. And I'm going to apologize to you because I am going to tug on your heartstrings this morning. And I'm going to do that because God has been doing that with me. And most of the time when God tugs on my heartstrings, it comes with tears. And so I just felt like it was the right thing to do to share those tears with you. So find out where that box of Kleenex is and prepare yourself. 1 Corinthians 13:12 says this, "For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know fully, just as I also have been fully known." Let's pray. Father, we just thank you that you are a God that is all-powerful, all-knowing, and perfect. And yet you still desire to have a relationship with us. Lord, we praise you that you are a God who knows where we are and is willing to meet us right where we are. And Lord, today we ask for the ability to see more clearly, more so than we ever have before. And Lord, may your words come out today. May your message to each one that's here, including myself, be very clear. Let you speak and love myself, I pray. In Jesus' name. Amen. There are many things that we don't understand in life. We look at a lot of things that happen, but we just don't understand them. We don't understand mentalities. We don't understand actions. Sometimes we don't even understand our own actions and the things we do. And many times, the things we don't understand or our misunderstanding drives us more than our understanding. 1 Corinthians is very clear that we only see things dimly. In this life, we do not have a full understanding of everything that takes place, of everything that goes on around us, of everything God has for us. And we have to kind of learn that. It's only when we're going to stand before Him face to face that we're going to understand it fully. So we kind of need to grasp that right now, that we're not able to grasp and understand everything. But there's a difference between what we know and how we understand what we know. For example, take a look at this picture. Now, some of you who were at my house last week can't talk, but somebody tell me what that is.
Trough.
Close. This is a manger. This is what we saw when we went to Israel. This is what Jesus was put in when he was born. It's not the nice little cross-framing wood piece that we see in manger scenes every Christmas. This was a manger. We see things dimly. We don't quite understand. We only see in part. But what would happen to us if we began to understand more about what we do know? What impact would that have on each of our lives? How would it change you and me? And one more question for you. Do you think there's a reason God doesn't want us to know everything? Well, I believe many times what we don't know or what we don't understand frustrates us and hinders our relationship with God. It gets in the way. It affects our understanding and the deep love that he has for us and leaves many of us feeling like a failure. And before I go any further, I want to just thank the praise team this morning because that really, your worship brought such a feeling of God's love here. I hope you all felt that. I certainly did. It was just awesome. So what brings us to this place of failure, depression, hopelessness, despair? What keeps us here? And what happens if we were to be released from this place? Well, first of all, let's talk about what gets us into this place. We all get here. We may not be here right now, but we have either been there or we're going to be there. Because everybody gets there. Some of us get there on the fringe, and some of us are deep into it. Okay? But we're all going to get there. The answer for how we get there is easy. Life. Life and what happens to us brings us there. Disappointments, unfulfilled hopes, unfulfilled expectations lead us to feeling like a failure or put us in a place of despair. Proverbs 13:12 says this, "Hope deferred makes the heart sick, but desire fulfilled is a tree of life." I want to show you a short video. It comes from the movie Facing the Giants. I don't know if you've ever seen it, but it's actually one of my favorite videos. In this clip, Coach Taylor is just coming home. He has just learned that the fathers of several of his players want the principal of his high school to fire him because he cannot win. And he hasn't been winning for the 6 years he's been there. He has a house that's falling apart, a car that's falling apart, and he's just found out that there's a physical problem with him that causes him and his wife not to be able to have children.
Have you been to school all this time?
Yes.
I tried to call you an hour ago. Is everything all right? Grant, talk to me.
I don't know where to start.
What's going on?
I was trying to lock up for Steve. And I overheard Dan meeting with some fathers. They didn't know I was there. Brooke, they're pushing him to get rid of me. Neil Prater, Alvin Purvis, Luke Ray. And they said I wasn't capable of winning. Call me dead weight.
They can't make Dan fire you. You still got support. You just go get JT and Brady and see him tomorrow.
Brady was there. They've just lost confidence in me. You know, I was so sure I could turn this program around. And I've just sunk it lower. Brooke, I've tried so hard. Why can't I win?
You can win. Stop beating yourself up, Grant.
Brooke, I can't provide you a decent home. I can't provide you a decent car. I'm a failing coach with a losing record. And I can't give you the children you want.
What?
It's me. Like everything else is me. We can't have our own children because of me. What's God doing? I mean, why is this so hard?
It's okay, Grant.
My son was born, memories like like a coat so warm the cold wind can't get through. Looking at me now, you might not know it, but I've had my moments. Well, I stood there trying to find my nerve, wondered if a single soul on earth would care at all. Miss me when I'm gone. That old man just kept hanging around, looking at me, looking down. I think he recognized that look in my eyes. Standing with him there, I felt ashamed. I said, you know I I've had my moments, days in the sun moments. I was second to none moments when I knew I did what I thought I couldn't do. Like the day I walked away from the wine for a woman who became my wife in love that, when it was right, could always see me through. Looking at me now, trash can fire tonight, that old man tells his story one more time. He says, I've had my moments, days in the sun moments. I was second to none moments when I knew I did what I thought I couldn't do. Like that cool light on the East Street Bridge when a young man almost ended it. I was right there, wasn't scared a bit, and I held to pull him through. Looking at me now, you might not know it. Oh, looking at me now, you might not know it. I've had my moments. I've had my moments. I've had my moments. I've had my moments.
But we forget, and we somehow don't believe The other things the Bible says, like love never fails. God created us to have a relationship with us. He did that knowing we were going to run away from him, knowing that he was going to have to chase us to bring us back. And even after he brought us back and brought us to him, he's still chasing us every day, trying to draw us closer to him. And his love never fails. So his love in creating us is not flawed. Which means us being created, who we are, as we are, is not flawed. And where we lived, or where we were living, or where we grew up, or where we're growing up, in the family we're in, and the situations we're in, is not flawed. There is a purpose. There is a reason for it. But it's hard for us to understand God's love. It's the love that is so hard to understand because we don't see it. We weren't given it. I'm going to get a little personal. I'm going to tell you a little bit about me. I love hearing stories about Pastor Daryl and his family because they are awesome. Deborah and I are actually, Deborah's writing a book about the pastors at Tri-County assemblies. And their relationship, father and son, is so incredible. It just reminds me of Pastor Daryl and his dad. But I didn't come from that kind of a relationship. I didn't come from that kind of a family, even with Deborah. And it's my experience as I talk with people that most people don't come from that kind of a family. They come from more like mine. I was born into a family with 6 kids. My mother didn't work. My father sometimes worked 3 jobs to make ends meet. We didn't have a lot of money. But in reality, we weren't really lacking much. We had a house, we had rooms, we had TVs, we had a car, you know, toys, clothes. We went to school. But the one thing we didn't have was love. My parents were very, very angry people. And it wasn't until I was 27 years old and had moved to Charlotte, North Carolina, that I understood that my family, my parents, and what they had done to us was child abuse. I took what we took, or all of us did, as we were kids, believing that this is the way things were, this was the way it was supposed to be. We didn't realize it. My mother's favorite way to discipline us, she would take her thumb and her forefinger, and she would take the nail of her thumb and dig it into your arm until she pinched it, and then she'd twist it. Pain was terrible, but the bruises were worse. We went to school with bruises all down our arms. And the funny thing was, nobody said anything about it. None of our teachers, none of the principals, nobody we saw at church. And we went to church. My father's favorite way to discipline, well, he had two. He had an electrician's belt. And if you've never seen an electrician's belt, it's more of a fabric belt with 2 rows of rivets all the way through. They sting. And he was not particular on where he hit you with them. But his favorite way to discipline us was just to slap us. There was one time I learned how much my brother and I, our voices sounded so much the same, that he was in an argument with one of my other brothers, I have 4 brothers, about a bicycle, and then he left the room. My father had worked all night, had come home, told him to stop arguing, went to bed. I walked in the room and said something about a bicycle, and my father came flying, I mean flying out of his room into my room, and started slapping me. Now at the time we had a set of bunk beds, and my head was just the height of the metal railing of the bunk bed. And my father kept slapping me till every bit of anger in him was gone. My mother was pleading with him to stop, but every time he hit me, my head hit that rim. Those were my parents. I swore I would never be like my parents. But the physical abuse wasn't the only abuse that we got from them. They also verbally and emotionally abused us. They constantly made us feel guilty about what we did or did not do. They constantly called us lazy, incompetent, stupid. They believed we were the cause of everything that went wrong in their home. And they never believed anything we said. And so, unfortunately, As much as I did not want to be like my parents, I grew up to be just like them. And while I was being just like them, I was swearing I wasn't like them. In my early years in college, I found the Lord. I got saved. And I got saved because I believed my life was going to change. That everybody and everything around me was going to get nice. I was finally going to have this nice life where people loved me and cared for me. The torment was going to be gone. But that's not what I found. My life just got harder. My parents rejected me. My whole family rejected me because of my belief. They thought I belonged to a cult. They thought I was reading the wrong Bible. And I just tried everything I could to survive. And the only way I thought I could get away from this was to get out of the house. And the only way to do that was to get married. So I did. I got married. And I got out of the house. They didn't even show up. And I thought I knew more than what my parents thought. I thought I was stronger than what they thought I was. But in the back of my mind, I was still very, very insecure. I took my anger with me. And I began to imitate my parents with my family. The cost was extremely high. I had very, very expensive counseling. I had several horrific relationships and marriages. I had many, many embarrassing moments. And I went through a lot of prayer. And there was times I was on my knees begging God, asking him that same question. Why is this so hard? Why aren't you hearing me? Why isn't this changing? But through that, I finally came to realize how angry I was. So I was able to deal with the anger, forgive my parents, and myself, and move on. But unfortunately, that wasn't the end of it. That wasn't the end of the story. God had a plan for me that I was not aware of. And that plan required me to deal with a lot of things. And what I didn't know is from there, I was headed to the deepest valley I had ever been in. I thought that was enough. Well, there was a pain so deep inside of me that I didn't really understand it. And I didn't really even know it was there. But it drove me. And I couldn't understand why, because I had forgiven my parents. I had thought I had moved past that, gone over that. But it was still there. So again, I'm in counseling. And it took a while, but I finally got to the point of realizing that pain. And experiencing that pain, and letting that pain out. When it came out like a flood. And I processed through that. There were days that it was hard just to get out of it and face the day, but I did. And it was a time when I was alone, by myself. I had no friends, no family to support me. And I was turning to God every day, but not seeing results. So I still pleaded with him. I pleaded for the pain to stop. And it drove me to writing this poem. And Deborah and I set this poem to a video, and I wanted to show it to you because I think it's something we all ask ourselves.
Is there a length to pain? I ask myself today, an amount of time that must pass by before it fades away. Or could it be that pain is not measured in this way? in the form of hours, weeks, years, and months, nor minutes of a day. Maybe pain comes in waves, in masses, you might say. Like balls and chains we drag behind us, our lot in life to pay. Could it be in volumes, in containers that would store? Pools of liquid and one of tears that from my eyes is there a length to pain, an answer to my plea, a way to know when the pain would go? And I could again be me.
Drawing us to Him, or bringing us to the place thinks he needs us to be. So with all this love that we find and we understand and we know about, what keeps us in this place of despair, this place of hopelessness? Again, the answer is easy. It's unbelief. Very simple. Just like I believe God exists, I believe he sent his son to die for me, and I technically believe that he loved me, but I never felt it. I couldn't grab a hold of that belief, that understanding, that knowing. And we get in this place because we get beaten down. We get beaten down at work. We get beaten down by our families. We get beaten down from our friends. We get beaten down by disappointments and things that don't go right. And that keeps us in this place. We also get beaten down by watching other people getting beaten down. And it continually separates us from the love that God has for us. It makes us doubt God's love. It makes us doubt his promises. There are three main reasons for why we stay in this place. The first one is unconfessed sin. We can't expect that we are not going to sin. We are sinners. We are weak individuals. We are made incomplete. We are never going to get to a point where we do not sin till we stand face to face before God. So accept that. Not that it's, like Paul says, it gives you a reason or a right to go sin, but accept that it's going to happen. And when it does happen, I made a mistake. You ask for forgiveness from God and from whoever you offend, you move on. You keep going. If we don't confess the sins, or if we continue in the sins, or hide the sins, it gives Satan an opportunity to come into our lives and help build that wall. And he loves building that wall. The second reason we stay in that place is because we live in a fallen world and it becomes less and less godlike every day. And if we let what happens in the world supersede what we know or our time spent with God, it will engulf us and it will keep us in that place, keep us behind that wall. And lastly, the last thing that keeps us in that place is our sense of failure makes us feel alone. And makes us want to stay alone. We wall ourselves off, we keep away from relationships with family and friends, and we just want to be alone. Partly because we're ashamed, I was. Partly because we didn't want people knowing what's going on in my life. Partly because we're afraid to share. Partly because we don't trust. And those are the things the church has been really guilty of. I've seen many, many churches that are horrible. Church I used to go to in Charlotte, the minute you share something, the whole church knew it. But that's not how it is here, and that's not the way God intended it to be. We are here for each other. We need to support each other. We need to love each other. We need to be available to each other. We need to get to know each other, which costs time, effort. We are so busy in our lives these days that we forget that the most important thing is actually sharing it. Sharing it with our spouses, sharing it with our kids, sharing it with our neighbors, our friends, our family. What we're so busy doing won't do a thing to comfort or remove or help someone come out of that land of despair. I want to show you one more video. Because I think this video, when I saw it, it spoke to me, and this is probably the one that made me realize it was time to share this.
We pray for blessings, we pray for peace, comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity, we pray for your mighty hand to ease our Yet love is way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? We pray for wisdom, your voice to hear. And we cry in anger when we cannot feel you near. We doubt your goodness, we doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not.
And we need each other to motivate and encourage us.
We know that troubled times will come because Jesus told us they will. And in those times, we need to be encouraged to face them, to believe in the God who created us, and He wants to give us His best. I want to show you one last video. It's a little long, but it's also from Facing the Giants, and it is, to me, one of the most motivating scenes I've ever seen in a video. You can tell, films do. But it really touched my heart, and I pray that it touches your heart. In this video, Coach Taylor has finally met the Lord. He's got something that's going on inside of him, and now he's trying to change his team and bring it to his team and encourage his team. Watch and see how he does.
Your attitude's like the aroma of your heart. If your attitude stinks, it means your heart's not right.
You sure is preaching today.
Mm-hmm. What?
How's your attitude, Brock?
It's fine.
Then you'll be okay with the death crawl, right?
Oh. All right, everybody on the goal line. Get your partner. Let's go. All right, let's go. Show me something. 10 yards. Move it. Move it. Let's go. Let's go, Matt. Let's go. Let's go, Jonathan. Show me something. 10 yards. Show me some power. No knees. Keep your knees off the ground. Show me something. There you go. 10 yards. Show me some muscle. Show me some power. Give me some heart. Let's go. Very good, boy. Very good. Let's run it back.
Oh, man, God. Oh, man, not even funny, dude.
So, Coach, how strong is Westview this year?
A lot stronger than we are.
You already written Friday night down as a loss, Brock?
Well, not if I know we could beat them.
Come here, Brock. You too, Jeremy.
What, am I in trouble now?
Not yet. I want to see you do the death crawl again, except I want to see your absolute best.
What, you want me to go to the 30?
I think you can go to the 50.
The 50? I can go to the 50 if nobody's on my back.
I think you can do it with Jeremy on your back. But even if you can, I want you to promise me you're going to do your best.
All right.
Your best.
Okay.
You going to give me your best?
I'm going to give you my best.
All right, one more thing. I want you to do it blindfolded.
Why?
Because I don't want you giving up at a certain point when you could go further. Get down. Jeremy, get on his back. I get a good tight hold, Jeremy. All right. Let's go, Brock. Keep your knees off the ground. Just your hands and feet. There you go. A little bit left. A little bit left.
I bet he
does.
There you go. Show me good effort. That away, Brock. You keep coming. There you go. It's a good start. A little bit left. A little bit left. There you go, Brock. Good strength. That's it, Brock. That's it.
I'm out of the 20 yet.
Forget the 20. You give me your best. You keep going. That's it. No, don't stop, Brock. You got more in you than that.
I ain't done. Just resting a second.
You gotta keep moving. Let's keep moving. Let's go. Don't quit till you got nothing left. There you go. Keep moving. Keep moving. Keep moving, Brock. That's it. You keep driving. Keep your knees off the ground. Keep driving it. Your very best. Your very best. Your very best. Keep moving, Brock. That's it. That's it. That's it. Keep going. Don't quit on me. Keep going. Keep driving it. Keep your knees off the ground. That's it. Your very best. Don't quit on me. Your very best. Keep driving. Keep driving. There you go. There you go. That's it. You keep driving. Keep your knees off the ground. Keep driving it. Don't quit till you got nothing left. Keep moving, Brock. That's it. That's it. That's it. Keep going. I want everything you got. Come on. Keep going.
It hurts.
Don't quit on me. Your very best. Keep driving. Keep driving. There you go. There you go.
He's heavy.
I know he's heavy.
I'm bad out of strength.
Then you negotiate with your body to find more strength, but don't you give up on me, Brock. You keep going, you hear me? You keep going. You're doing good. You keep going. Do not quit on me. You keep going.
It hurts.
I know it hurts. You keep going. You keep going. It's all hard from here. 30 more steps. You keep going, Brock. Come on. Keep going.
It burns.
And let it burn.
My arms are burning.
It's all hard. You keep going, Brock. Come on. Come on. Keep going. You promised me your best. Your best. Don't stop. Keep going.
Too hard.
It's not too hard. You keep going. Come on, Brock. Give me more. Give me more! Keep going! 20 more steps! 20 more! Keep going, Brock! Give me your best! Don't quit! No! Keep going! Keep going! Keep going! Don't quit! Don't quit! Don't quit! Brock Kelly, you don't quit! Keep going! Keep going! Go, Brock Kelly! You don't quit on me! No! You keep going! You keep going! Go, Brock! 10 more steps! 10 more! 10 more! 10 more! Keep going! Don't quit! Give me your heart!
I can't do it!
You can! You can! 5 more! 5 more! Come on, Brock! Come on! Don't quit! Don't quit! Come on, Brock! 2 more! 1 more!
It's got to be 50. It's got to be 50. Oh, how many more?
Look up, Brock. You're in the end zone. Brock, you are the most influential player on this team. If you walk around defeated, so will they. Don't tell me you can't give me more than what I've been seeing. You just carried a 140-pound man across this whole field in your arms. Brock, I need you. God's gifted you with the ability of leadership. Don't waste it.
Coach?
Can I count on you?
Yes.
Coach?
What is it, Jeremy?
I weigh 160. Who's next?
All right, who's next? Who's going to face the challenge and keep going? And who's going to be there to encourage them on? That's really what we need to do. To come out of despair, sometimes it takes a while, and it takes a lot of hard work, and it takes someone there pushing us. We need that kind of encouragement. We need each other. That's what God is trying to do for us. And a lot of us aren't listening. I know I wasn't. And I thank God for the people that came alongside of me and helped me. And I think that's what God expects us to each other. That's what Paul talked about in supporting each other, bearing each other's burdens. But that's an investment that we need to make in each other. And take it from two people who have been there, it's well worth it. Ask the praise team to come back up. We're going to sing one more song. And as we're singing this song, I want you to listen to it. Because the song is about how we want to praise our God. And we, as weak, incapable beings, this song is about the best that we can give. But I want you to think about the fact that that's only this big compared to what God has for us and his love for us. So I want you to listen to this song, and I want you to think about it as if it's God singing it to you. And then if God moves your heart, altar's open. There's nothing special about being up here. But there's certainly something special about you placing yourself in God's hands, saying, I am ready to give up my worries, my struggles, my attitudes, the things that keep me building those brick walls, so that I can have something.